Good afternoon. Good afternoon and Happy New Year. Thank you, Virgil. Welcome to the first lecture of the 2012 Food for Thought Luncheon Lecture Series. I'm Mary Kay Cooper, Director of Alumni Relations. This series is sponsored by the San Antonio Alumni Chapter and coordinated by the Alumni Office. The series is designed to spotlight Trinity's outstanding faculty. Before we get to today's talk, I would like to tell you about an upcoming event. The university's annual MLK Jr. commemorative lecture will feature Ilyasa Shabazz, daughter of Malcolm X and Betty Shabazz, an author, producer, and activist for social justice. She will discuss Growing Up X at 7 p.m. Tuesday, January 17th in Laurie Auditorium. The event is free and open to the public. We are pleased to have several special Trinity people with us here today, and I want you to be able to recognize them. They are President Dennis Ahlberg, and his wife, Penelope Harley, and Vice President for Academic Affairs, Michael Fisher. I want to remind everyone that this program is being recorded so that people all over the world can view or listen to it later. So, no pressure. So during the question and answer period, please come to the microphone to ask your question. Thank you. Our speaker will be introduced by Alex Phelan, class of 1972. Alex is a director on the San Antonio Alumni Chapter Board and retired in 2008 after a 35-year career in education. Alex.
Thank you, Mary Kay. I'm here to introduce our speaker for today, Sussan Siavoshi. She was born and raised in Iran. Sussan Siavoshi earned her BS in economics from Pahlavi University in Shiraz and her Ph.D. in political science from Ohio State University. Dr. Siavoshi has been teaching political science at Trinity University since 1986. She teaches a variety of courses in comparative and Middle East politics as well as in political theory. Dr. Siavoshi's first book on liberal nationalism in Iran, The Failure of a Movement, published in 1990, was the result of her interest in the question of why liberal nationalism, which informed the discourse and character of political activities in the late 1940s and early 1950s, eclipsed so easily during the massive revolution of 1979. The book transpired wide interest not only in the U.S., but in Iran as well, and it was translated into Persian. Dr. Siavoshi is the author of several articles on contemporary Iranian politics, ranging from studies on factionalism of the elite, to behavior and philosophical outlooks, to Islamic feminism, to film and literature in post-revolutionary Iran. Her latest book, the one she's working on at this time, is an intellectual biography of the Grand Ayatollah Hossein Ali Mataziri, a man who started as one of the main architects of the Islamic Republic political system, but dismayed by his excesses, left the position of power and became a dissident Ayatollah fighting for human rights and for a democratic polity. In Iran, I'm sorry, I stumbled over that word. Dr. Siavoshi, you ready?
Thank you very much, Alex, and thank you all for being here. It's a pleasure to see you. The first time I did one of these speeches, Food for Thought, which was about 20 some years ago. My topic was United States-Iranian relationship. And I predicted, based on thinking about certain principles, that Iran and United States do not have important and substantial differences, geopolitical, strategic differences. Therefore, my prediction was that Iran and US will and should patch up things. Boy, was I wrong. But I still do believe that in those principles that inform my prediction, meaning that I do believe that there is not enough that separates the two countries in terms of their interest. And unfortunately, based on certain domestic imperative pressures, lobbies, the short-sightedness of elites in both countries, that now we are witnessing a very dangerous situation. I'm just keeping my fingers crossed that things get better. But today, I'm just gonna mostly talk about domestic politics of Iran and talk whether Iran is ready for another revolution. However, and related to that is of course our own policy in the US, of this newest round of sanctions that are quite draconian. So I'm going to ask the question of whether Iran is ready for another revolution. Let me go to this. This is the image of people who gathered in street of Tehran and similar gathering in other parts of big Iranian cities after the result of 2009 presidential election was declared. Most of these people deemed the result to be fraudulent, and that Ahmadinejad, who was the incumbent president, did not win, and his rival, Mousavi, had won the election. So this image provide us with another similar, it evokes another image, and that image is from, let me see if I can, nah, all right. Another time, another period, and this is 1979, when the peaceful demonstration of Iranian ultimately led to a full-fledged revolution. So the question that informs my talk is whether Iran is ready for another revolution. So let me ask the audience, I'm going to be a little bit unorthodox. How many of you think that a revolution might be coming in Iran? Just raise your hand. Wow, not very many. And is there a courageous soul to tell me why? They think that? You don't have to, but if anybody is interested, no? And the rest, yes?
I think people who have power hold on to it.
So you don't think that there's going to be a revolution?
No.
Okay. What I'm going to do today is to give you two scenarios, or actually talk about two ways of looking at factors, bringing up factors that might, in fact, make Iran ready for a revolution, and therefore, in conjunction to that, that the sanctions might work, because the sanction is really not to, it's not so much geared for Iranian elite to change its behavior, not to go for nuclear weapon, but it is for regime change, as a very high intelligence officer said, and you can read that article in Washington Post a day ago, day or two ago. and the sanctions have become more draconian, so it will hurt Iranian people, so they will revolt against a very unpopular regime. So the first part of my talk is to point to those factors that actually lend support to the argument for more sanctions. The second part of my talk, I also want to go beyond those factors and particularly show you certain evidence, statistics, images that point to a different direction that might say, in fact, sanction might provide a much more support for the regime, solidified people against what they see as unjust interference in their internal affairs, and therefore the regime might become more intransigent and strong in its position while people are suffering. So I'll give you both, and you can decide for yourself which one is more important or more salient in a sense. Well, first of all, what is a revolution? A revolution is usually a rapid, many times violent overthrow of a political system, which may or may not follow by social revolutions, economic, changing economic system, cultural system, etc. And why revolution happened, there are all sorts of theories. There is no, however, there is no one-fit-all theory that explains why revolution happened. Some people think it's put their emphasis on psychological aspects of revolution, that anger explains why people rebel, like Ted Gare, for example. Or some people put their emphasis on a structural factor. Some people put their emphasis on poverty. Some people put their emphasis on frustrated expectation that fits that psychological approach to revolution. Some people argue that foreign wars and things like sanction can precipitate a revolutionary war or revolution in Iran. So if we look at the Iranian situation, some of those factors are present. One of them is, for example, that Iran has a political system that is monolithic, it is dictatorial, a supreme leader. In this case, the founder of Islamic Republic, Ayatollah Khomeini, who died in 1989, created a kind of system that the power is concentrated absolutely in the hand of one man. It is also a theocratic system. Iran is also under the Islamic Republic have created a kind of atmosphere that everybody is oppressed, and nowhere we see in our media the oppression to be symbolized by the veil of women. So in many instances we see women veiled and this hovering image of the founder of the revolution just, you know, over their head, and it's always present. So there is also quite a good deal of violence. We saw that violence after the 2009 election. There were a lot of beating of people, many of them just innocent, peaceful protesters. There were hundreds of people who get arrested. I'm sure that some of you remember the image of Neda, that young woman who was shot as she was just standing there, and you saw the image of her dying. There were lots of torture. I mean, there were lots of people who were tortured. Newspapers were closed down. So the situation was quite tense. There is a tremendous amount of violence against the citizenry. The civil liberties were all crushed. So you see a regime that becomes more and more entrenched and meshed with violent activities. The image of Iran is also an image of poverty and underdevelopment. There are slums, there are people who live in areas that, you know, there is no running water, there is no, it seems that people have to go get their water with these little tanks and plastic tanks, etc. So when you look at these images, you get a sense that here it is, a very poor country spending millions and billions of dollars on weapon acquisition and also sort of showing it off by certain you know, days of demonstration, whether it's in the Persian Gulf or whether it's inside Iran. So what, when you see that, those images, and then you see also certain statistic about unemployment, especially among younger people. Let me show, take this. It doesn't work. Does it work? Well, anyway, if you look at the youth, the two upper, why doesn't it work? Let's see. Well, it does. Can anybody help me? Anyway. I guess it's self-explanatory that it's usually both rural youth and urban youth that suffer from unemployment, and the unemployment for the urban youth in particular.
Just aim it right there.
Oh, aim it.
Yeah, aim it.
Okay. Thank you. Yes. Ah. I'm just pushing it. Anyway, you see this is a urban unemployment's gone up, and this is the rural youth unemployment, and then if you look at the overall the adult, meaning adult are over 25 or so years old, or 25 or 30, you see that's not that bad, but it's just, and if you look at the evolution that happened in Tunisia or in Egypt, you see that those who actually started the revolution were the youth, and a big part of it was unemployment. So Iran is vulnerable to that. Also, if you studies are done about what youth do, if they can't find unemployment, they become frustrated. There are a lot of people who are now on drug users, and the rate of suicide is very high in Iran. So generally speaking, you look at this factor and you said, what's not there not to like or to hate, or what's there not to have? I can't say it. Anyway, what's there not to hate? Nothing. I mean, so people are ready, and they should eventually. And it's true that the government uses oppression, but oppression don't always work. I mean, people get fed up, and at some point they will revolt. And the sanctions, draconian as they are, because they're going to suffer, they're going to attack, or they're going to affect the population, the citizens. They're not going to affect the elite. And the hope is that having these factors in operation, that by putting sanctions, people will revolt and there is going to be a regime change. And of course, the hope is that as soon as you have a different kind of regime, that regime will halt nuclear energy productions, or eventually a nuclear weapon. That is the argument. That is the argument that's been made by a certain group of people, including many scholars. Now that I talked about that, I would like to also address a few factors that might complicate this, because the situation in Iran is messy, it's complicated. It's complicated in its political makeup, political behavior of the elite. It is much more complicated in terms of issues like education, poverty, and so on and so forth. So, one thing I forgot to mention, and that is that in addition to these factors, one factors that people usually talk about, those who are pro-sanctions and pro-revolution or speak that revolution is coming, is what is going on within the society. This and that is that the majority of people are against the regime, and they, by the way, this is men and women rate of unemployment. You see, women are even more unemployed, and the rate of it's greater for women, especially in certain ages, than it is for men. But if you look at society, younger women, younger men, younger women, younger generation, basically oppose the regime politically. These are people who were present during 2009 Green Movement in support of the other candidate. They also show their opposition to dressing in certain ways. These are in the streets of Tehran. I don't know whether you can call this veiling. Especially this one. All of them. I don't dare wearing this kind of thing here. So especially that, this, you know. Anyway, so there are socially, in social occasion, you see combining men and women together. Usually it's frowned upon that men and women who do not know each other should not be sort of so close to each other. But these are people who in one park started having water fighting, and in fact it became an issue, and some hardliners said this is really unacceptable, and we should put these people in prison and etc. And there were people who says, oh, come on, let go of this, I mean, lighten up, it's people don't have any much to do, so this is one thing they can do, so let them go. But anyway, these are the images of what seems to be the majority of Iranian who are under stress, who are under oppression, and they would like to get out. So these were the people who are welcoming a revolution in Iran, and if sanctions put them put pressure on them, they will go into the streets. Then on the other side, which is a minority, according to this approach, is that there are people who are just ideologically blindly support the regime, or are basically traditional people with not much education, and they just follow the rules of their parents and husbands and so on, but they are not really that very many of them. And they are going to be overwhelmed by this majority younger generation, well-educated people, because these people are mostly uneducated, and they don't have a chance eventually. Now, I would like to mess up a little bit this neat view of Iran. If you look at the power structure in Iran, it's quite messy. Yes, there is a supreme leader at the top here, but the supreme leader gets elected by an assembly of experts, which itself is elected by the people. And then you have other elected officers. And so there is a Republican side to the constitution of Iran. In fact, the IRI, Iranian Republic, or Islamic Republic of Iran, has a very bifurcated character. There are theocratical articles on one side, you have Republican side on the other side. And even though civil liberties are really undermined, but there is a contestation among the elite. There is a factionalism that's going on, and this contestation slip over into society, and many of these contesting people try to get support from certain part of the society, and it's not true that the supreme leader always win. In many cases, supreme leaders stay out. Not so much recently, but generally. Right now, for example, that they got rid of the Green Movement or pushed them underground, the contestation is between two groups of conservative. On the one side, you have Ahmadinejad and his supporters, and on the other side, you have this traditional conservative, and they differ. They differ substantially from each other. Ahmadinejad and his cohort are trying to talk about Iran and Islam, Islamic and Iranian Islam. They are much more open to cultural changes, while the conservative on the other side are not. You would be very surprised, especially those of you who have heard Ahmadinejad incendiary remark about Israel or Holocaust, that his closest advisor have said things that are very dangerous for him. He, for example, he said, we are friends with Israeli people. A long time ago, he said that, a few years ago. Or Islamism is like, in comparison to other ways of dealing with issues, it's like a horse and cart in comparison to a speedy train. So we should get rid of this. So you can see there are stuff going on in Iran that are not reflected here. We usually think of Iran as a monolithic, very dictatorial regime, and it is in some ways. As I said, civil liberties are crushed left and right. Some people get arrested, torture exists, and so on and so forth. But on the other hand, there are these aspects going on in Iran that makes it really sort of interesting and complicated. There are elections that are, even though to some extent restricted, are not as restricted in some point on this man whose name is Khatami. He ran for president in 1997, and this man who is the supreme leader right now didn't like him. He had a different candidate in mind, but the electorate voted for Khatami, and they led him to become president of Iran. So it's not that elections are all sham. It depends on the timing, it depends on the configuration of forces, it depends on how serious the competitions are, what are the forces at that time, etc. How am I doing in terms of time? Okay. All right. People go to booths, election booths. I mean, this is the feel good about voting. In the last presidential election, there were campaigns and there were debates. Very interesting debate. I watched those debates. Mousavi, who was the Green contender, really let Ahmadinejad have it in terms of foreign policy, in terms of domestic policy. He says you put Iran in danger, the things that you said, blah, blah, blah. So these things really make people go to the street and gather around him. He's, by the way, a very lackluster person. He can't talk very well, but things that he said mobilize a lot of people in his support. And this is another campaign rally. And those rallies are a lot. It's not that the rallies themselves were crushed. So what I'm trying to say is that elections mean something in Iran. It is not that just everything is set from earlier on. Another thing I wanted to talk to you is the poverty rate in Iran. Many scholars or media people talk about how poor Iran is, or how poorer it has become. But in fact, if you look at the rate of poverty by region, not just in urban areas, but also in rural areas, it has gone down. And the reason it have gone down is mostly because of the policies of the state. State go to the villages, provide them with education, with health, with clean water, with power, and those have some sort of impact. Another way of looking at the welfare of people, economic welfare of the people, is the amount of consumption, particularly private consumption as opposed to public consumption. Private consumption has gone up much rapidly than public consumption. And what else? If you look at the Human Development Index, by the way, Human Development Index is a kind of index that include not just income, but education, level of education, and level of health. And if you look at, again, Iran, you will see that it has moved much faster than many other countries. It's not that far from countries with high human development, which, and that's another image of quality of life index, and Iran is sort of in the middle, but a little bit higher than middle. It's better than India. It's same level of China. Okay, so this is the education, education expenditure as percentage of gross domestic product, and you will see it's about 5.7. If you compare that to the amount of expenditure percentage of GDP for military, you will see that it's much higher. Iran's expenditure on military is about 2.7% of its GDP. So it's not that Iran push all the, of course, you can always say that there are items that are hidden. You don't know whether there are items that they put in some other, but you can say that almost about all countries. And I'm sure that there are items that are not shown here. Literacy rate, that's another thing that is Iran has done very well. If you look at these pictures, you will see that at this time literacy is between 90 to 100, and if you look at the time of the Shah, which is supposed to be a modernized country, only 3% of rural women were literate. Now it's much higher, very high in fact. And one other factor which I want to talk about is annual population increase. Iran has been very successful in decreasing the number of the rate of increase of the population. So Iran used to be just sort of pyramidal this way. Now it's a little bit sort of going this way. And that is an interesting thing, because one of the things that we talk about is about modernization and traditionalism. Iran is considered as modernized during the Shah because he had family law, which was actually a good law. I mean, women and men became very much equal. But family structure in private was very, very traditional. Now when you look at it, the law is gone. It's been replaced with a terrible law. But family behavior has changed. Families do not want to have very many children. Family would like to spend a lot of money on the education of their children. And that's a sign of modernity in some ways. So you see a kind of transformation and private aspects, no matter what the elite is saying, things are happening within the society that seems to be that make it a large section of the society that used to be modern, traditional, much more modern in terms of its behavior. And you know, I want to show you a few pictures of life as normal life, because again, the pictures that we get from Iran is usually a underdeveloped country. Everybody is on each other's throat, or government is on each other's throat. This is a metro system. People, you know, these are shopping mall. People go shopping. People, men and women, sometimes unrelated, sit here. This is a cinema complex, and people just go, and there are people who go to, you know, have little picnic, and there are sport, despite the fact that you have to cover yourself, but people engage. I mean, people are lively. They try to make the best of it under any circumstances. There is a concert. As you can see, there are people with hijab or veil that are part of this orchestra. There are movies like Separation that is now might be a contender for Oscar, the best film, and these are coming from Iran. Iran has a very, very lively movie production for years. These are art installation. People go. So there is a normal life as well. I mean, not everything is shouting or violent anti-government. There is that. But what I'm trying to also say that there are a lot of people who are in support of the regime who are not just, you know, ideological or whatever. And the reason I say that is that the education that the government have provided, there are a lot of people who are not educated from villages, from other areas, and these people are supporters of the regime. Why? Because the regime provided it for them. They're not all necessarily sort of, as I said, wide-eyed ideological or ignorant people. So far, I mean, if you take these kind of factors and images and compare that to what I show you in the beginning, it should start make you think differently about the impact of sanction. There will be people who have benefited from this regime materially, who also, I always say people that Iranians are very proud people. To them, the sanctions are unfair interference in the affairs of Iran. So to them, if the sanctions start hurting them, they're going to rally around the flag. At least this is the another argument we can think of. So I'm going to leave it to you people to think what to think about sanctions. But no matter what you think, there is one thing about sanctions historically that they never worked. You take Iraq, Saddam was never hurt by sanctions. There were people who hurt. There were five, according to some United Nations statistic, there were hundreds of thousands extra death as a result of sanction. It was called silent killer. Now, if you're ready to kill a lot of people for the sake of regime change, fine. But the question is that whether regime will change as a result of this. So whether there will be a revolution or not is an open question. It's always very hard to predict. Revolutions always surprise you. Thank you. I will be happy to answer some questions. May I have some water, please?
war. And I've always sort of considered them natural enemies, predators. But since we went into Iraq, did we ruin that? And is that now why Iran seems to spend a lot of time trying to harass us?
Well, Iran and Iraq, do you hear me? Or do I have to go there? Iran and Iraq were, in fact, in competition during Saddam. But if you look at the demography of Iran and Iraq, the majority of Iraqis are Shiite, the same way as Iranians are. Now, they have a better relationship right now because the Shiite government is in power. Now, I think if you look at the evidence, it is not true that Iran worked against U.S. for most of what was, when was the war was happening in 2003. In fact, Iran, that's why I'm talking about the interest. Iran worked with the occupation forces or our occupying forces in Iraq to get rid of Sunnis, because at that time we wanted to get rid of the Baathis, of the Saddam people, and it was the interest coincided. So Iran for a long time, when I said a long time, for a while, when it before it became one of the axes of evil, was helping. Even after that, to some extent, helped with the Sunni until the creation of, I think it was 2006, that US made a deal with some Sunni groups. But generally, the picture is a little bit more complicated than Iran and Iraq, Iran and U.S. being on each other's throats in Iraq. And I don't see why we can go back to that kind of cooperation. The same way in Afghanistan. Iran is a swear enemy of Taliban, so was United States, and Iran was helping United States. Again, prior to 2003, and now the Obama administration says that Iran has al-Qaeda people in Iran, and that's actually sort of fishy in a little bit, in some ways, because if you look at again reactions of Iran to al-Qaeda when U.S. attacked Afghanistan, about 150 al-Qaeda operatives went to Iran, and Iran arrested most of them and sent many of them to their country of origin, and it actually asked for the help of U.S. to send the others. But that was the time that we already got into the idea of axes of evil, so all cooperation stopped. I guess that's what I'm trying to get at. I think partially it is the domestic politics of our country and theirs as well that creates certain situation and basically make the real common interest sort of opaque by bringing up other issues. I still do believe that Iran and U.S. do not have any serious underlying strategic issues with each other. Did I answer your question? Sort of.
Just first a word of thanks. It means a lot to me when we're shown the other side and the other face of a Middle Eastern country other than as depicted in the media. So thank you for giving us such a vivid account of daily life as well as of the complexities. Supposing there is a revolution, mm-hmm. what do you think the role of the military will be? Would they turn the guns on their own people?
Depends on what we mean by the military. Iran has not just the regular military force, but it has Basijis, It also has revolutionary guard. So there are several different kind of military forces. One unfortunate thing is that Revolutionary Guard is also very much involved in the economy of Iran and economy as is. So I would say that the Revolutionary Guard will go with it. Will not go with the revolution, will go with the elite. That said, during the election of Khatami, who was a liberal president, when they look at the box of votes that they got from a military barrack, actually a revolutionary guard, their vote for Khatami was larger percentage-wise than the vote of the general public. So there were a lot of support for him. Also, there have been some military people who expressed support for the other candidate. Now, again, going back to your question, I think the regular military probably will have a harder time. But this Basij group that the regime is sort of giving a lot of money and all sorts of stuff, they are there now to support the regime for their own benefit. And I don't think they are going to side with the people.
When you were talking about the choice between a revolution and not a revolution, are you ruling out fundamental change achieved democratically through
elections? No, I never have, although some people accuse me of being optimistic. That was what I've done most of my work on, in terms of I put a great deal of emphasis on elite factionalism. I also talk about how democracy really is not this way, but democracy can go this way. And therefore now we are in a period of really bad period. But it doesn't. I still think that through reform, something can happen. I have become part of a minority voice in that sense. More and more people have gone toward the revolution. But I do.
You mentioned very little about women.
Mm-hmm.
And I wonder about some of these, what you might call silent revolution.
Uh-huh.
Like the women's group, uh-huh. They have any real standing as far as making a revolution, what I call a quiet revolution.
Yes. That has actually been going on for a long time. In fact, there are a lot of feminists who are also Islamists. I mean, and they, you don't have one group or one solid monolithic women's movement. There are lots of different women's movement at the private level, at the public level. It is true that the regime has targeted many women just because they are women and they want to scare them, so they go into the house and keep their children quiet. But a lot of women, they are very resilient. You have mothers' organization. You have feminists in the parliament. You have, as I said, Islamist feminists, journalists. You have also secular feminists. You have a lot of lawyers. You have a human rights activist. But I think they have decided that they have to work as a nation with men in order to change things. But there are small little things in the parliament, for example. Even some women who were traditional or conservative in some other ways passed through the parliament things like giving wage to women who work at home. If you nurse your child, your husband has to pay you. Not everybody does, but it is a law. Even though a lot of things had taken away from women because of getting rid of that family law. But when you marry, you can in fact stipulate there are some prenuptial agreement that everybody has to sign. They give up some right, but in terms of dividing the assets, in terms of custody, of children, in terms of right to divorce, you can have it. What complicates that to some extent is class issue. Women from the upper class have the support of their family. They are also educated, not that the others are not, but they're more educated, they have more connection. So they're much more aware than some other. One last thing I want to say, that as long as you don't get into the area of law, which is discriminatory against women, Iranian women are very powerful in the house. So in the house, most of the decision, a lot of decisions are made by women. But once you decide to get a divorce, once you are in direct confrontation with your husband, then you're in deep doo-doo. Could be. Yes,
ma'am. A question, or maybe two questions. One is, do you think Iran is developing a nuclear weapon?
It is very hard to say. If you go by NPT and IB, the international agency, they never really have smoking gun or something. They basically said we don't have a real evidence. But there are countries and people who tell us about some of the things that happen. So if you go with that, you don't exactly know. Now, I don't like the Iranian regime, but if I were in charge of Iran at this moment in its history, you look at the map of the area. On the one side, you have Pakistan and Afghanistan. Afghanistan is just sort of in shambles. Pakistan has a nuclear weapon. On the other side, you have Iraq, which is still sort of connected to US and Afghanistan as well. You have Turkey, which is part of NATO. You have the Persian Gulf area, which is under the umbrella of US protection and armed to the teeth. And you're isolated. What would you do? And you see the one country which didn't have nuclear weapon, like Iraq, one of the axes of evil, and North Korea, another axis of evil, which had nuclear weapon, and see how big countries react to them. So they think that if we have nuclear weapon, and by the way, I really do believe that the Iranian regime, even though they're not very good with own people, they're not suicidal. They're not going to attack Israel. They're not going to attack the United States with a nuclear weapon because they know that they're going to be obliterated. That's as then Senator Clinton, Hillary Clinton, or maybe she was Secretary of State then too, said that we're going to obliterate Iran if Iran attacks Israel. So it is not so much for attacking it as an offensive thing as it is a defensive. There are some people who argue that if Iran produce nuclear weapon, then there are going to be an arms race and everybody wants to have it in the region. Well, then maybe we should start thinking about a global way of getting rid of nuclear weapon. I don't know. But I'm saying that if I were in the mind of an Iranian leader, I probably would go for it because of the position. So your question that you asked, whether I think, yes, I think. I think they are developing, even though we don't have evidence, hard evidence.
One observation about that would be that Saudi Arabia doesn't have a nuclear weapon. They're in the a neighbor, and they seem to be doing pretty well. But the other question I was going to ask you is about, it's just if President Obama called you up to the White House tomorrow and asked you to advise him on U.S. policy toward Iran, what would you tell him?
Start talking to each other. Because again, my view is that we don't have a real conflict of interest that should keep us apart forever. There is a lot of ego massaging that should go. There are a lot of distrust going on. But if you really look at, if you're a realist like Kissinger or Brzezinski or people like them, they would probably say the same thing, that as far as real politics is concerned, as long as the interest is concerned, we don't have much to fear of each other. We shouldn't. But there are other things that goes into it. Irrationality, fear, distrust, as I said, pressure of other groups. And then that's where we are. So if I were invited by President Obama, which I would never be, but if I were, I would say, even during Cold War, we had a channel of discussion with our sore enemy, Soviet Union, so we won't get into a situation that we decide something based on lack of information. I think we should start there. We should start building some sort of, having some channel of communication and then build on it.
Okay, we have time.
If anybody would like to talk to me.
Thank you so much, Dr. Siavoshi. That was fascinating.
Well, thank you. Thank you. It was really a pleasure being here. And thank you for your question.
I would like to thank all of you for coming to the first lecture of the series. Our second lecture is scheduled for February 1st, same day and time. And the speaker is Jane Childers, Associate Professor at the Department of Psychology. She will speak on explorations of the mental processes children use when learning new verbs. We look forward to seeing you again next month.